Good morning and welcome to our service of worship for Palm Sunday. As we enter God's presence this morning, we hear from the Old Testament prophet Zechariah, words taken from chapter 9, verse 9. Rejoice, O people of Zion. Shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious. Yet he is humble, riding on a donkey, riding on a donkey's colt. For the past 5 weeks of Lent, we have been journeying through the wilderness and preparing for Jesus' suffering and death and the celebration of his resurrection. Today, together with the church worldwide, we begin Holy Week by welcoming our Messiah. Just like the people on that first Easter, we want to begin our journey today with Jesus as we follow him to the cross. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, on that first Palm Sunday, you entered the rebellious city of Jerusalem where you were to die. You knew what that week ahead meant for you, and you knew the failures of your disciples, the changing hearts of the crowds, yet you continued your journey. This morning, Lord, would you continue your journey with us? Enter our lives, inhabit our praises, even though you know that we are just like the people of Jerusalem all those years ago. Lord, today as we worship you, may we lay down our lives rather than our palm leaves. May we bless your name and cry, Hosanna, save us. King of glory and of peace, servant king, reign in our hearts and lives today and every day we pray. Amen. We sing together that great hymn, To God Be the Glory. And on this Palm Sunday, let us raise our voices and praise as we sing out that chorus. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice.
Jesus, we see. the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son.
To remind each of you that every evening this incoming week, Holy Week, we will be meeting with our brothers and sisters from some of the other churches in the town, albeit remotely, as we think on the subject of how Jesus meets us. Our topics for the week, taken from Jesus' own experience through his journey to the cross, we are going to look at how Jesus meets us in our anger, our sorrow, our suffering, and our isolation. Each of these services will be available on our Facebook page and YouTube channel at 8 p.m. each evening. Unfortunately, there will not be a community service for Good Friday in the square, as current restrictions mean that we cannot gather together. But we do meet on Friday evening as we return to our own building for the first time since the end of December. Our Good Friday service will be at 8 p.m. in the church, and again will be live streamed to Facebook and YouTube. This service of reflection will be led by Brian Burns, Chris Matheson and myself. I'm also really thankful to Father Martin O'Hagan, who has recorded a song specifically for our service on Friday evening. It is, however, important to remind anyone who is returning to the building that all the precautions that were in place in the autumn when we were worshipping in the building will still be in place. So please keep 2 meters distance from anyone not in your household or bubble. Wear a face mask at all times unless you're exempt for medical reasons. Use the hand sanitizers provided on the way in and the way out of the building. And remember to use the one-way system, entering through the main doors and exiting via the shell room. This is also if you need to leave during the service for any reason, please exit via the shell room and re-enter through the main doors. We are so grateful to meet again in person, but at the same time we acknowledge that some of you may feel wary of returning to the building. And so all of our services will be live streamed to both Facebook and YouTube. At present, regulations only allow us to meet for corporate worship, that's worship on a Sunday or the likes of Good Friday, but no other activities will be recommencing until further notice. On Easter Sunday morning, we will be back in the building and we'll be joined by the Reverend Dr. Heather Morris, who will lead us in our Easter service of worship and communion. But back to this morning. As we focus on the account of Palm Sunday, we want to hear the words from Matthew chapter 21. Sylvia is going to read for us the first 11 verses.
Jesus' triumphant entry. As Jesus and the disciples approached Jerusalem, they came to the town of Bethage on the Mount of Olives. Jesus sent 2 of them on ahead. "Go into the village over there," he said. "As soon as you enter it, you will see a donkey tied there with its coat beside it. Untie them and bring them to me. If anyone asks what you are doing, just say, 'The Lord needs them,' and he will immediately let you take them." This took place to fulfill the prophecy that said, "Tell the people of Jerusalem, look, your king is coming to you. He is humble, riding on a donkey's colt. The 2 disciples did as Jesus commanded. They brought the donkey and the colt to him, and threw their garments over the colt, and he sat on it. Most of the crowd spread their garments on the road ahead of him, and others cut branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Jesus was in the center of the procession, and the people all around him were shouting, "Praise God for the Son of David! Blessings on the one who comes in the name of the Lord! Praise God in highest heaven!" The entire city of Jerusalem was in an uproar as he entered. "Who is this?" they asked. And the crowd replied, "It's Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth in Galilee."
We join together in praise as we sing that Palm Sunday hymn, "Ride On, ride on in majesty. Let us confess our sin before God. Loving God, today we remember how your Son entered the city of Jerusalem, and that in just a few days the words of the crowds changed from crying Hosanna to crying Crucify. Lord, we confess this morning that so often our will is as rebellious as the people of Jerusalem, and our faith is often more show than substance. Jesus, you are our King, yet so often we do not act like it. You came in humility, riding on a donkey to serve and give your life for the world. Too often we fail to follow your example. We live our own way and reject yours. On this Palm Sunday, we are reminded how quickly our loyalty to you can diminish. Forgive our hypocrisy and apathy. Lord, give us passion for you as we remember your passion for us throughout this week. Help us to lay at your feet all we have and all we are, trusting you to forgive, to heal, to restore and to save. Thank you, Jesus, that you meet us where we are. Thank you that your love never fails and that forgiveness is always available at the cross. Merciful God, as we enter Holy Week, turn our hearts again to Jerusalem and to your life, death and resurrection. Stir up within us the gift of faith that we may not only praise you with our lips, but follow you in the way of the cross. We thank you that the cross brings forgiveness for all our sins. So this morning, Lord, we worship and praise you. Amen. Our second reading this morning is found in Hebrews chapter 11, verses 32 to 40.
How much more do I need to say? It would take too long to recount the stories of the faith of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah, David, Samuel, and all the prophets. By faith, these people overthrew kingdoms, ruled with justice, and received what God had promised them. They shut the mouths of lions, quenched the flames of fire, and escaped death by the edge of the sword. Their weakness was turned to strength. They became strong in battle and put whole armies to flight. Women received their loved ones back again from death. but others were tortured, refusing to turn from God in order to be set free. They placed their hope in a better life after the resurrection. Some were jeered at, and their backs were cut open with whips. Others were chained in prisons. Some died by stoning. Some were sawn in half, and others were killed with the sword. Some went about wearing skins of sheep and goats, destitute and oppressed and mistreated. They were too good for this world, wandering over deserts and mountains, hiding in caves and holes in the ground. All these people earned a good reputation because of their faith. Not one of them received all that God had promised. For God has something better in mind for us, so that they would not reach perfection without us.
We're reaching the end of our journey through the wilderness and are heading into what we know as Holy Week. We've been preparing ourselves to journey with Jesus into his most difficult and barren period yet, his betrayal, trial, crucifixion, and death. We, of course, know the end of the story, that the horror of Good Friday and the numb waiting of Easter Saturday will explode with joy into the victorious resurrection of Sunday morning. But for those who live through that first Easter weekend, the struggle of this week was all too real. They had no way to be sure it would all turn out okay. Our own wilderness experiences can be very much like that. Looking back, we can see how God has used dry, barren, and difficult times to shape us. But when we are in the middle of them, it is almost impossible to get that kind of perspective. And when good things come along, they can take us by complete surprise as God works in mysterious and unpredictable ways. I only have to look at my own journey of faith. I could never have imagined when I was walking through the difficulties of having my strokes and being diagnosed with a brain tumour that God could truly use this. But because of my ill health, I had to come out of work for many years. It was during this time when my life suddenly became a whole lot less cluttered and I was forced to have more rest and quiet time that I heard God speak and call me into ministry. A call which I had laid down when life hadn't turned out as I had hoped many years earlier. But now in the wilderness of ill health and recuperation, God spoke again in that gentle voice, just as he had done for Elijah thousands of years before. If I'd never walked through that wilderness, I may never have been in the place spiritually, emotionally or physically to hear God's call. And that would have meant that we would have never been with you here in Cumber. We all have our story to tell. And when we read the account of Hebrews 11, of the heroes of the Old Testament, we see similar kind of pictures. The writer of Hebrews describes giants of faith who nevertheless lived through some literal and metaphorical wilderness experiences. These were not super spiritual people who floated through life on a cloud. They struggled in the deserts of sorrow and rejection, of physical violence. In the midst of this, the writer records some amazing answers to prayer. We are told that they were people who, through faith, conquered kingdoms, administered justice, and gained what was promised, who shut the mouths of lions, quenched the fury of the flames, and escaped the edge of the sword, whose weakness was turned to strength, and who became powerful in battle and routed foreign armies. Women received back their dead, raised to life again. As we hear these verses, our minds can't help but turn to some of the people in the Old Testament. Through faith, they conquered kingdoms, makes us think of people like Joshua or the judges of the Old Testament, of David, amongst others. Kings like Solomon, Jehoshaphat, Hezekiah, and Josiah are remembered as people who administered justice. And though not perfect, They were characterized by righteousness and justice. When we think of those who gained what was promised, we think of the covenants made between God and Abraham and Moses and David and Solomon. Again, none of them perfect. All of them traveled their own wilderness, each for different reasons. Deliberate sin, half-truths, fear, worshipping other gods rather than the one true God, or sometimes God led them into that wilderness. Yet they received the fulfillment of God's promises. All of us who attended Sunday school or children's meetings when we were younger will know the stories of Daniel and the lion's den and his three friends, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who were saved from the fiery furnace, and of David's escape from Saul's murderous attempts, or Elijah escaping from Queen Jezebel, each of them a more escaping the sword. The writer of the Hebrews summarizes all these people by saying, whose weakness was turned to strength and who became powerful in battle. Is that your story? Can you look back and see times when you were weak, but that God made you strong and you overcame? All the people mentioned in this chapter of Hebrews did see amazing answers to their prayers and their acts of faith. But when the writer comes to the end of the account, this is admitted. He says, they were all commended for their faith, yet none of them received what had been promised, since God had planned something better for us, so that only together with us would they be made perfect. The fulfillment of the promise that these fathers and mothers in the faith were looking for was only going to come in the Messiah, in Jesus. The hopes of the people of God were pinned on this Messiah. He comes not as a military superpower, but as a helpless baby. He lives not as a rich politician, but as a homeless wanderer. He preaches, and it's not vengeance to Israel's oppressors, but grace and love for enemies. And his triumphal entry into Jerusalem is not on a chariot of war, but fulfills the prophecy of Zechariah from hundreds of years ago. When we heard those words, rejoice, O people of Zion, shout in triumph, O people of Jerusalem. Look, your king is coming to you. He is righteous and victorious, yet he is humble, riding on a donkey's colt. The surprising answer to all of Israel's hopes is a humble man on a donkey. A humble man who would further humble himself to die on a cross. The crowd who welcomed him with palm branches and shouts of Hosanna would by the end of the week turn on him. The cross that appeared to be his final defeat would turn out to be his final victory over death, sin, and the devil. His resurrection would become the first fruits of the resurrection of all things. It is the guarantee of the promise through Isaiah, where it says, even the wilderness and the desert will be glad in those days. The wasteland will rejoice and blossom with spring crocuses. Springs will gush forth in the wilderness and streams from the wasteland. The parched ground will become a pool, and springs of water will satisfy the thirsty land. Those who have been ransomed by the Lord will return. They will enter Jerusalem singing, crowned with everlasting joy. Sorrow and mourning will disappear, and they will be filled with joy and gladness. A wonderful promise of things yet to come. So what about us on this Palm Sunday? Well, we live in the in-between. Jesus is risen, death is defeated, and we have the availability of salvation of Christ and the power of the Holy Spirit. And yet, God hasn't quite finished with this wilderness world. He holds back Christ's final coming, and so we continue to experience both wilderness struggles and resurrection surprises. The promised land is before us, So the writer to the Hebrews encourages us to take heart from the Old Testament heroes and from Jesus to finish this journey together when he says, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of faith. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." Journeying with Jesus means drawing strength from him during the hard times. We know that he has walked this wilderness road before us and that he is walking with us now. He's using even our struggles to transform us and to prepare us for the day when all sorrow and sighing will flee away. The book of Revelation tells of a future day when palm leaves once again will be waved. Let us hear a passage from Revelation chapter 7. "I saw a vast crowd, too great to count, from every nation and tribe and people and language, standing in front of the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed in white robes and held palm branches in their hands. And they were shouting with a great roar, 'Salvation comes from our God who sits on the throne and from the Lamb.' And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living beings. And they fell before the throne with their faces to the ground and worshiped God. They sang, 'Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and strength belong to our God forever and ever. Amen.' Then one of the 24 elders asked me, 'Who are these who are clothed in white? Where did they come from?' And I said to him, 'Sir, you're the one who knows.' Then he said to me, 'These are the ones who died in the great tribulation. They have washed their robes in the blood of the Lamb and made them white. That is why they stand in front of God's throne and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will give them shelter. They will never again be hungry or thirsty. They will never be scorched by the heat of the sun. For the Lamb on the throne will be their shepherd. He will lead them to springs of life-giving water, and God will wipe every tear from their eyes." I love that passage in Revelation. It just gives us a little glimpse of what that's going to be like. But are you going to be there? Will you be one of the vast crowd joining with people from every nation, tribe and tongue? The great promise of this future palm-waving day is for all who accept that this Messiah who came was Jesus and died in your place. As we journey once again through another Holy Week, journeying towards that cross and waiting of Easter Saturday and the joyous resurrection of Easter Sunday, I urge you, don't rush to Sunday, but journey with Jesus and retrace his steps through some of the most difficult wilderness experiences, because it's only in doing so that we truly understand the miracle of the first Easter Sunday. And when we do, nothing will stop us from bowing the knee and worshipping him. I would love that we were all there on that next palm-waving day in glory. But it comes back to the cross. Today, on this Palm Sunday, as we see Jesus riding humbly into Jerusalem on a donkey, knowing what lies before him, he's doing it for you and he's doing it for me. Will you accept this Messiah? Will you accept him as your Savior? And when Easter Sunday comes, can you celebrate your risen Lord with the knowledge of knowing another day will come when you wave palm leaves around his throne? Amen. We finish this morning by singing the beautiful hymn that reminds us of that future glory. There is a higher throne.
Through the loud believing hearts, find promised grace.
Let us pray. Jesus, we have walked with you this far. May we not abandon you in this Holy Week, but stay by your side through your sorrow, that we might also join you for Resurrection Sunday, for your glory. Amen. Now, as you rise from this time of worship, may you be surprised by God on your journey. May you fix your eyes on him alone, and in your weakness, may you know his strength. Amen.